Hello and welcome to Everything You Need to Know About Print on Demand. Today I'm going to be joined by Ian Barham from King & McGall and Mark Ryan from Fanbase. And today's agenda is going to be: what is print on demand? How does it work? Some pros and cons for print on demand. And our experts are going to talk about their top tips and best practice, as well as trying to add in a live Q&A at the end. So very action-packed, so let's unpack this. So the first question is, what is print-on-demand? So print-on-demand definition is a business model that allows sellers to produce items of their catalogue only when a customer demands it. And also, a print on demand, the manufacturer will then actually create the product and manage the delivery to the end customer. So as you can see, a print on demand solution could be the right solution for a lot of museums and art galleries where perhaps stock is an issue, access to that is an issue, resources and time is an issue. So print on demand can potentially be a really interesting model to dive into. If you're looking to expand ranges, but don't necessarily have a huge team to be able to fundamentally dispatch them. So what are the most typical items for print on demand? So these are the key areas of print on demand that we commonly see. So we've got apparel, which can be a case of, goes from rucksacks to t-shirts, to hoodies, to hats, to trainers, which is a new area that I've kind of seen the last couple of years, through to stationery, which we're probably more familiar with, all the way through to wall art, which is really common. And I know that Ian's going to be talking about the wall art on print on demand, and even books. We may not necessarily think of books as a print on demand solution, but that is actually another key area that is actually booming right now. So quick benefits of print on demand, just to kind of get everyone up to speed. So what are the benefits of print on demand? That's what we're here to find out today. So number one, you can create products really quickly. You have no stock risk because you haven't manufactured anything up front. So you're not sat there with lots of stock at your museum or art gallery, because it's more of a digital offering and the end product gets given to the customer rather than sit within your books. You can order wider product ranges, wider product ranges with your one particular high-res image. It's relatively low investment. You can achieve more sales, which is what we want to be looking at today. It's highly profitable, and I know Ian and Mark are going to be looking at the strategies around how that is possible, and also around easier fulfillment for you guys as organizations. So how does it work? I'm gonna take you through now a video which explains exactly the process of print on demand. I just want to say that there is lots of print on demand companies out there. This is just one that I think really articulates the actual print on demand journey. So I'm just gonna play that now for you guys.
Printful Print On Demand drop shipping helps you launch an online store with low risk and without investing in printing equipment, storage, or inventory. We handle all your fulfillment and shipping so you can spend time on the fun part of running a business. Here's how. To get started, you need a Printful account, which is free, and connect your online store. We connect with a bunch of e-commerce platforms so you can choose the one that suits you best. Next, use our mockup generator to create product images with your designs for your store. Sync as many products as you want with your store. You're only charged when someone makes an actual order in your store. Your profit depends on the retail price you set. So let's say you're selling a t-shirt for $20. And our fulfillment price for that t-shirt is $12. That means you'll get an $8 profit for every t-shirt you sell. Once your store and products are ready, start selling and we'll take care of the rest. As soon as someone buys a product from your store, the order information is automatically sent to Printful. We charge you for fulfillment, print and pack your product, and ship it directly to your customer under your brand. And that's how Printful Print On Demand Dropshipping works. Hey, it's Wes from Printful. I hope you found that video very...
Just going to pause there. But hopefully that gives you a bit of an understanding of how the print on demand section works. And like I said, this is Printful. There's so many more out there. And again, I'm sure Mark's going to be able to fill in quite a lot of detail around that. He's one of our experts. The next section was I wanted to talk to you today was most print-on-demand suppliers actually have the following key areas. So it's free to set up an account. Most are able to connect with your existing e-commerce store. Most of them also are able to provide a product mock-up generator, which you can potentially take your high-res image and put it against t-shirts, into books, notepads, etc., etc. I will let Mark talk about that in more detail. And also, they're able to provide an integration to automate your orders from your online shop. Now, if you're unsure what I mean about automating and integrations, it simply means that if a customer comes onto your online shop and you've got a print-on-demand product sat there, the customer effectively goes through, they buy that t-shirt within your basket, the back-end office actually takes that order, rather than you manually sending it to the dispatch, you know, to the end distributor, that automatically, or that order automatically goes to a print-on-demand supplier, where they're able to, the fifth point, take care of that fulfillment and shipping. So all you need to do in terms of once you've created that print-on-demand product and it's sat on your store is to make sure that you are marketing that product to your audiences, and a print-on-demand company will look after the rest. And again, it's, you know, provides a profitable product margins for you because you're not sat there with stock at the museum or art gallery. Here's another example I wanted to show you guys, and it's about books. I know we had quite a few poetry companies sign up for this webinar. So I wanted to just show you what do we mean about print on demand for the book industry.
I'm Eileen Gittins. I'm the founder and CEO of Blurb, and I'm sitting here at Blurb's headquarters in London. Blurb is a creative publishing platform that enables anyone in the world to make a proper book, a beautiful book, designed by you. And it used to be those were just print-only books, but now they're ebooks too for your iPad. And it's not just a print replica on the ebook, you can also now include audio and video as well. And you can sell them in our bookstore at blurb.com, and you can make money on your books as well. I started the company because I'm a photographer. When I started to look into this business of could I use print-on-demand technology to produce a book, the number one criteria for me was image quality. Could we as a business faithfully reproduce the intention of the artist, whether you're a photographer, a designer, an architect? I mean, that work needed to look, beautiful, right? So with that as a backdrop, that was what was the guiding force behind, okay, how could I enable everyone in the world to create a really beautiful, proper book and get it printed and back in a week's time, and especially if they only needed one copy? So the way it works is you design your book using the tools, you upload it, and then what happens is that file in real time goes to our print facility in Eindhoven, and it's printed on demand, whether it's a book, a magazine, whatever.
My name is Jan van Baar, and we're now in the state-of-the-art book factory from RPI Paro in Eindhoven. What you see behind me is a print-on-demand book factory where they can produce books by just one number, one unique printed product. What happens now is that we are in the middle of a digital revolution, and printing-on-demand is a part of this. Printing-on-demand is taking over the market from the older ways of printing, because people won't need large numbers in one time. They want to have it tailor-made one by one. And printing on demand is part of the revolution that will provide this.
A book is no longer as precious a thing as we used to think of it. You could do it all the time. You could change it tonight. If you're an architect and you've done a new project and you've got a book on file, well, right, just add the new project to it. Maybe edit something old out and you've got your latest and greatest work. It's always available. You can always get it printed on demand. I think it's completely changed how we think about books. They used to be permanent, you know, that you might make it once and maybe you'd make a second edition. God, now you could make an edition a week if you wanted to. It's fantastic, actually.
So that was Blurb. But again, there are a lot of other print-on-demand companies that actually deliver books as well, but I just wanted to give you that as an example. So if we move on, I just wanted to talk about the pros and cons for print-on-demand, just because it wouldn't be right just to kind of talk about print-on-demand, you know, being a complete solution. I think it's really important to understand some of the cons around whether print-on-demand is right for you. So some of the pros for print-on-demand is that you can create that range of products quickly. So on the right-hand side, this is this mock-up where you can put all your imagery potentially on lots of different elements here. And, you know, it's just a really quick, effective way to be putting products up, and you can test ideas without necessarily having any consequence. The supplier deals with the shipping and fulfillment, which again, I've said before, but it's something that's really, really important. I really wanted to discuss on this. There's low investment, again, as there's no stock inventory held. Like I said before, you can test ideas at low risk, which I think is really important, especially at the moment. And it's a really agile business model. And I'll go into further details about that next. The sort of the cons to this is the cost of goods will be more expensive, which means you may need to price items higher. Now, what do I mean by this? So for a T-shirt, for example, if you were to get it printed, in my past history of working in the music industry, maybe a T-shirt would cost you like £3.65 to get printed on a sort of standard T-shirt, Gildan T-shirt. Now, if you were to do a print on demand, it'd probably be £7. However, when you get them printed and it's 365, you have a minimum order quantity where I had to order, say, 50 if I was lucky, or 100, or it could be 500. And then you're stuck with the inventory and you've really got to make sure that product sells so you can start seeing break even. Now, where print on demand comes in and it's really valuable is the fact that, yes, it's £7 rather than £3, but you don't have any of the worry of thinking, is this product going to sell or not? Obviously, you want to kind of create a product that you know is going to be really liked and loved by your audiences, but it's just a different type of model. And the other thing around that is to do with the margin. So if you're wanting to sell a T-shirt for £15 and it costs you £3, obviously that's the margin there, but you still want to sell that T-shirt for the same for print on demand, obviously the margin is looking slightly slimmer, so you might have to inflate those prices to make that margin that you're needing. You could have less control over shipping costs because of the shipping that goes, you know, for global stores. So once sort of check in with print on demand around like what does shipping look like for global, you know, if you're shipping something to Japan versus shipping something to America, like what does that flat rate perhaps shipping look like for you guys? Limited product customization. Again, I know Mark's going to be talking about this, but choosing the right print on demand company that has the right printing techniques or the right product mix that you want is really important. But also just to let you guys know that you can actually have multiple print on demand companies plugged into your shop if you're using things like Shopify, WooCommerce, etc. So you don't have to necessarily just have one type of print on demand organization plugged in. And it's also worth checking on shipping times because they can differ, and also around quality may differ. And I've got an example of that that I'm going to show you in the next couple of slides. But my top tip for print on demand would be always get samples before you look to put that product out on the market. So who is using print on demand? So I want to give you an example of an artist. So it doesn't always have to be big organizations. You can be using print on demand if you're a photographer, you're an artist, you're a musician. And this is just an example of what can it look like for print on demand for a small artist. Now, this is an artist we decided to use PrintSpace. They're a London organization who does basically prints. However, they have a third party called Creative Hub that you can kind of plug in, and that plugs into, which this store is a Shopify store. And again, it's worth kind of looking at the quality, because I decided to try and use Printiful for them. And this is the kind of quality that we got with Printiful, which actually came from Latvia. Really, I wanted to look to support local if I could, especially because a lot of the audience at the minute will be in the UK. And this is what PrintSpace actually did. And we're really happy with the quality for this. And the paper's really nice. It's on German etching. And so, yes, it's kind of worth kind of looking at different print on demands when you're thinking about projects and really making sure you're getting samples to get the right print on demand. Now, obviously, print on demand will be a lucrative business for someone like an artist because they've got the original works there, the original paintings, which they can ship out themselves and make decent margin. But where it becomes really interesting around prints is an artist isn't going to want to get three or four printed out and then they've got to spend all their time shipping the logistics because that's what they weren't interested in. They wanted to be able to create works that they really love doing and have a print on demand solution take care of all those prints and all the logistics side. So that's an example of a small artist kind of looking to venture into online shops with a print on demand supplier. Another example where organisations in the sector are looking at print on demand is Art UK, which is an arts charity. During lockdown, actually, they've looked to extend their offer. So there, if you look on the right hand side here, they've actually now started to use print on demand for merch items, which is very new for them. They used to do on the left hand side, which is a print and framing. So more organisations are coming into this space. Another example is Tate. The Tate shop has an amazing variety of prints. And I know in lockdown, they saw a huge upsell in prints during this time. So without further ado, it kind of leads me up really well to introduce Ian Byron from King & McGall as they actually do all the fulfillment for Tate. So I'm going to transfer, hopefully, Ian to come on and talk about King & McGall.
Yeah, thanks, Emma, and hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. Just to give you a little bit of the background to King & McGall, we are a fine art publisher and printer and framer who were founded in the early 80s in Brighton, and we were an early adopter of print-on-demand technology. So in the past, if you wanted to publish an art print, you had to commit to a large print run up front because of the setup costs. If you were printing either as a screen printer or a lithographic printer, and then you had to store all of those prints that you'd already committed to until you managed to sell them through. But about 20 years ago, we started to make the move across to print on demand, which was possible at that time really with inkjet printing or giclée printing, as some people like to call it. Quality had really improved and has continued to improve over the years. And it meant that you could now do much shorter runs and indeed one-offs without committing to a large print run up front. And again, 20 years ago, there was a lot of nervousness in the art and museum community about print on demand. People were worried about losing control of their IP, and also people were worried about quality control. Whether it was artists who were signed for us to publish their work, or whether it was museums where we were fulfilling their orders for them, you know, what we've always strived to do is focus on very high quality prints and framing, staying true to the original color. And making sure we're reproducing with that accuracy. And really, you know, that world has gone from strength to strength. So there are plenty of artists and artist estates and rights holders who wouldn't allow print on demand 20 or even 10 years ago. But now, even if we're doing a major exhibition at the Royal Academy of Abstract Expressionist Work, for example, all of those major artist estates in America were quite happy for us to reproduce the work on demand. And I think just going back to what Emma was saying, you know, I think Emma's chart that was showing the benefits of print on demand are very true for, you know, individual artists and smaller organizations or photographers who are starting out on this journey, and they might be printing themselves or doing personalization themselves. But what we've done over the last 20 years is really invest very heavily in technology in order to make print on demand seem very simple. Those videos made it seem very simple from other companies, but there's an awful lot of work that goes on, a lot of investment behind the scenes to make it look that simple. So I think Emma's gonna control the slides today. And Emma shared with me and with Mark some of your questions in advance of this session. And so I've just covered off a few of the basic ones here. One of the first questions was just about the quality of image file. And here I'm really talking about fine art print reproduction. I know Mark's gonna talk about merchandise and the levels of high res files might be different for different product mixes. But for us, one of the best bits of advice, if you're an artist or a rights holder or an institution, is before you sell your original or before you archive your original or before you let it go off on a tour of other museums and galleries around the world, is make sure that you've got a high quality scan of that artwork so that you're then free to monetize it while the artwork itself might no longer be available to you. And just as a rough guide here, I've said really 3000 pixels on the longest edge of your image file is a good guide, but you really need the original photography to be high quality as well. There's no point having a large file if it's a blurry photograph or scan. And again, you really want an uncompressed file. You know, sometimes we get sent things which have been compressed in some way or been emailed around so often that there's some quality that's been lost along the way. So a kind of uncompressed, lossless file, something like 100% quality JPEG or a very large TIFF is also suitable. And when we're working, if files have already got an RGB profile attached to them, that just helps us ensure that quality of color reproduction is accurate, as that's what our printers are profiled to as well. One of the biggest issues with getting a print on demand program off the ground is more prosaic details, just as things like confirming the credit lines, confirming the copyright lines, making sure you've got very accurate and robust metadata that corresponds to the files that you're providing to whoever's going to do your fulfillment for you. And also, I think really crucial is having a robust contract in place in order to protect your IP. You know, you want to be very clear. As Emma said, you might have different print on demand providers who are making different products for you, and you really want to make sure that you're protecting your IP, that you're not being sublicensed out in other territories, that you're not ending up on products that you didn't give permission for. And you know, if you're publishing a promise to your customers who are on the front end of your website, you need to make sure that your print on demand provider is also adhering to that promise that you've made to your customers, because they're your customers after all. You're taking their money up front. And also a tip is to make sure you've done a credit check. There's lots of companies who are moving into this space, but you want to make sure that no one's going to go bust after you've already placed orders with them and let your customers down. And then I think the final point I've got here, which Emma always goes on about in a very positive way, is make sure you have a proactive marketing plan. It's very easy with print on demand because you've got no upfront or low upfront setup costs, but there's no point in putting that collection online without having a proactive marketing plan. And for e-commerce, really, there's three key drivers for e-commerce. One is driving traffic to your site, one is converting that traffic to purchase, and the third one is increasing the average order value of that converted traffic. So if you're thinking about those three factors, that's a very good start. Next slide, please, Emma. So just to give a brief history of the evolution of print on demand in the museum world, and just to clarify that we're the fulfillment partner for about 30 or so museums and galleries in the UK, including Tate, who Emma mentioned, and V&A, Royal Academy, National Gallery, British Museum, etc. And really the journey that those institutions went on was sort of 20 years ago, and this was before they had their own e-commerce capabilities in-house. Print on demand really started with touchscreen kiosks, which allowed those institutions to print orders themselves. And at that time, it was seen as a real positive that shoppers really liked to take away a purchase from the museum itself. You know, knowing that the National Gallery had produced your order was a real compelling selling story and helped convert to purchase. And National Gallery continue to this day to print unframed prints in-house if people want to take one away from the gallery while they're there. But if they want it to be framed or to have a stretched canvas or for it to be sent at a later date, then the orders come through to us. And then moving on from that, again, before museums had their own e-commerce platforms, there were companies out there who were offering white label standalone sites for print on demand. And the sort of model that was in vogue in the early 2000s, I think it was 2004, was the long tail model, where this idea was that you put as many kind of images up as possible. And the idea was if you had 100,000 images and sold one of them with print on demand, that was as good as selling 100,000 copies of one image. I think the downside to that, which was discovered later on, was really you're forcing shoppers to wade through lots and lots of images that they're actually not interested in purchasing. So as I've mentioned later on in this timeline, now it's much more about a curated collection of images and a curated collection of best-selling products, rather than offering everything in all sizes and frames and colors and formats just because you can. Moving on, you know, there was a stage where larger institutions, as you would expect, could afford to hire digital agencies to make in-house e-commerce platforms, and that would normally include an integrated print-on-demand offer. So that was the dawn of sort of single-user, single-basket orders, where you could cross-market effectively. So you could sell a ticket to an exhibition catalogue, and then a print from that show, and the print order would come to us in that scenario. And then really moving on and bringing us up to date, obviously there are other platforms in addition to Shopify, but certainly in the museum sector, it seems in the last couple of years that lots of museums have been using Shopify, but there's also WooCommerce and BigCommerce and others where they've set e-commerce shops up themselves. And as part of that, they've used a print-on-demand plugin to make that offer and send the orders to us or another fulfillment partner. And then, as I mentioned, really now the focus is on curated, focused offerings, not making your shoppers wade through lots of things they don't want to buy in order to find something that they do, and also just really focusing on the rise of mobile commerce as well. As I mentioned, there are three key drivers, and with this slide, I'm just trying to show for art prints at least, but I think it's applicable to other products. What you're trying to do is convey to the shopper exactly what the customizable options are. You know, a key driver is once you've got your shopper to this page, you want to make it very easy for them to understand the different variables, both in terms of size, in terms of frame choice, to understand that there'll be a border or there'll be a mount, and what the price differentials are there. So that is what we would call the picker page on the V&A shop looks like at the moment. And then again, we can't stress enough the importance of marketing strategy, and this is all about driving traffic. We launched a print-on-demand partnership with the Royal Albert Hall at the start of this year, actually. So this was pre-lockdown, but it's worked really well for the Royal Albert Hall, as sadly they haven't been able to welcome any visitors or hold any events for the majority of this year, but they've been very proactive, like a lot of institutions, online. And this is just a snapshot from the newsletter, the e-newsletter that goes out from the Royal Albert Hall. And each time we add a new collection relating to previous concerts from the era when you were allowed to go and have fun, they heavily promote, and he's Kylie Minogue. Coming on, Emma, I think my final marketing slide was again just about converting to purchase, and this is from the Penguin shop where we do the fulfillment for their prints. And again, one of the benefits of print on demand, you know, Penguin had been planning for their 85th anniversary, which was in July this year, to do a range of limited edition prints with children's illustrators such as Coralie Bickford Smith and Charlie Mackesy. And it became clear in lockdown that there was no way to do the limited edition product anymore, because that requires taking prints around for people to sign in person. The logistics were not just going to work. So what we decided to do was add the prints to the Penguin's print on demand shop. And actually this went live for their 85th anniversary. They were giving a large chunk of the profits that they would make to the National Literacy Trust. And I'm really pleased to say that so far Penguin have donated over £20,000 from sales of these five prints, which were available framed or unframed, to the NLT. So I think that's just showing the benefit of, you know, an active marketing strategy that recognizes the benefits of print on demand when traditional channels might be curtailed. Thanks, Emma.
Great, thanks, Ian. And on to Mark now, if we can switch videos.
Hello, everybody. And again, thank you for taking the time to join us today. Just a bit of background on me. I've been working in POD, or print on demand, probably for the best part of 10 years, mostly in the direct-to-consumer e-commerce fulfillment side on apparel and some other hardline products, but mostly textiles. But in recent years, moving into some crossover products such as print reproduction and other products like homeware and et cetera, as those products become more readily available in that print on demand space. fan base is a new concept, a new initiative, or a new company that I've formed in recent months, all geared towards empowering artists, mostly in the music and entertainment sector, to be able to sustain their careers. This was pre-COVID, but it's obviously more relevant now. To be able to, for any artist effectively globally, to be able to monetize their global fan base with zero risk and zero liability in terms of stock. so as you can imagine, with artists not touring or having access to money coming from live entertainment or live events, you know, there's been a massive shift towards direct to consumer and obviously print on demand, and e-commerce plays a massive part in that. If you want to move it on. Yeah. Right. Okay. So effectively what we're doing is saying that print on demand, empowering the arts. And I think, you know, in this context for this webinar, I think the blueprint is pretty much identical for the music industry as it is for the artist, whether that be fine art, street art, you know, museums. I think the blueprint is pretty similar. What we want to do is we want to be relevant and we want to be proactive. And obviously with the old traditional model, that is, you know, it's very difficult to do unless you have, you know, a big team and you've got deep pockets where you can manage the logistics of printing product and warehousing it, as both Emma and Ian have mentioned. But what print on demand enables you to do is, it enables you to kind of unshackle yourself from those day-to-day, logistics of selling direct to your consumer or direct to your audience. so effectively what Fanbase is trying to do is we're trying to generate additional revenue streams by leveraging an audience that you already have access to. So that's, again, without repeating myself, that's the same blueprint as it is for music, as it would be for for the visual arts, as we're kind of more emphasizing on at this point in time. In terms of, in terms of the outlets, you know, attending events, you know, visiting online exhibitions, buying tickets for events, these are all what I call activations that you can use or you can leverage to drive sales. So pre-event activations, you know, at event activations can all be used to drive sales and kind of monetize whatever IP you have access to or you manage on behalf of a customer or an artist. So you can move it on. So some of the products, I think print on demand from a merchandise perspective is starting to mature. It's going from kind of like a promotional model or products offering more into, we're moving into eco, we're moving into premium, we're moving into products that are more lifestyle focused because a lot of brands see themselves, you know, or are trying to steer themselves in the direction of being a lifestyle brand. So they want to obviously offer the product to their end customer that kind of lives up to their brand expectation. So we're seeing a lot of demand coming from our customers in the music industry looking for, you know, ethically sourced, sustainable, eco-friendly, vegan approved. You know, so we need to be ticking all of them boxes. So we're kind of moving away from that, you know, I suppose promotional pen kind of model more into the, you know, the lifestyle kind of brand focused offering. As you can see, this water bottle in the bottom corner, that's actually a good case in point. That's a water bottle that's 100% biodegradable. It's made from cornstarch. So it can be composted, you know, after it's kind of end of life, it can be composted. And that's the kind of the direction, the direction of travel that merchandise is moving. So yeah, you can move on. So what problem is POD solving? I suppose, you know, the problem is, you know, do you want a warehouse full of products? Do you want, you know, merchandise to be on your balance sheet, you know, year after year, month after month? And do you need your team or have a team that can manage that merchandise and the continuous cycle of that merchandise? You know, it's a massive overhead. So I think POD solves all those traditional problems and removes those headaches, but it also gives you the ability to tap into, you know, kind of undiscovered or unexplored opportunities. And that may be you have a catalog or back catalog from an artist that purely, maybe their catalog is so big that you just really haven't had the time or you just don't have the ability to offer every single piece of work from that artist. With POD, you could do that. You could build out a full store with catalogs going back as far as you have, you know, good enough reproductions of that artwork. So it kind of removes those limitations and creates those opportunities. Removes the risk. We've discussed that in depth, and I think that's a very big USP when it comes to POD. But that also gives you the ability to be experimental and to start using what I would call traditional kind of digital marketing techniques, A/B testing. You know, does that product or does that artwork sell through better on a red T-shirt versus a black T-shirt? You know, in the past you would have had to commit to those two colors in order to kind of do those, you know, to try and generate those kind of insights. But now you can do that quite freely and, you know, within minutes. Out of stock, you know, we've all had this issue where, you know, medium sell out quick, large sells out quick, or a particular size of print, you know, whether it be an A4, A3, you know, right up to A0 or whatever, sells out quicker, and you effectively, the next person in line that wants that print, you can't take that order. But now with POD, you can. So you kind of remove that missed opportunity for a sale. The other big thing is stagnant product collections. And what I mean by that is, many times if you've gone into, whether it be a museum store or even onto an artist's website, you know, month after month, the product offering doesn't change. And, you know, and effectively what happens is then you as a fan or you as a, you know, a customer, a potential customer gets bored. And the likelihood of you coming back is, you know, probably, you know, it'll probably be difficult to get you back, you know, unless you can really incentivize those people to come back. So you kind of negate that. Because the biggest cost in e-commerce really is, you know, getting eyeballs or getting people onto your site. You know, converting is another thing, but effectively getting them there, the cost of conversion, you know, is, or customer acquisition is expensive. I think I've heard a figure of, you know, about $100 just to get a conversion, you know, and it's quite expensive. So you have to sell a lot of product to get one individual person on that store. So it's expensive. So you want them coming back constantly. And that's where constantly refreshing your product offering is really what POD gives you the ability to do. Irregular product launches, I think, ties into the same thing where, you know, you want to be doing capsule drops or product launches as frequently as your audience can bear. You know, I think with fast fashion, I think ASOS do 5,000 new products a month. You know, I don't think we want to be doing 5,000 new products per month, but effectively, if you could add one or two pieces per month or change things up slightly every month or every week or every other month, at least it keeps your product offering fresh and you know, people keep coming back. Obviously POD then removes the logistics and fulfillment overheads, you know, which, and headaches, which we all hate, is packing product and, you know, getting it either to the post office or getting it ready for collection. And that's a big thing that POD removes. So so you can move on. So this is just some kind of overheads in terms of supply chain shift. There's a massive shift across all sectors towards on-demand, you know, on-demand being one thing in terms of supply chain, but definitely direct to consumer. The consumer wants to engage with the fan, with the artist, and the artist should want to engage with the fan. And I think that's what POD gives artists, gives them the opportunity to be closer to the fan and to listen to the fan and engage with the fan and give the fan what they want. And I think that shift to on-demand supply chain, you know, enables that and accommodates that. But just one stat in terms of apparel, year on year, it's a 10%, it's probably more than that now with COVID, 10% growth year on year, and that's been in the last 5 years, consistently. The market is at the moment is 2.3 billion. It's going to exponentially going to grow, you know, probably two or three times that before 2025, 2026. So we're seeing a massive shift away from the traditional supply chain to the more, on demand and more sustainable, scalable supply chain of print on demand. Smart distribution and sustainability, you know, kind of says it all. You can move it on. So basically what we're saying is, you know, especially with Fanbase, our model, we take the order in, we intelligently analyze that order, and then we route that order to the best placed of our fulfillment partners globally to do that fulfillment. And the whole idea is that we want to be fulfilling a t-shirt ordered in New York, we want to be fulfilling that on the ground on the East Coast of America. We don't want to be shipping it from a cold warehouse in East London somewhere. You know, we want to be, you know, being as sustainable as possible, you know, give the customer what they want in terms of, you know, getting the product to them from order to door as quickly as possible. But also bearing in mind, we want to be as sustainable and you know, as scalable as we possibly can. And that's where onshoring or POD kind of comes in and adds a lot of value in that respect. these are just some stats that I like to show in terms of volume from an apparel perspective. You know, POD, you know, outstrips volume in terms of sustainability, you know, hands down, even just down to pure water usage. You know, our process in terms of apparel production is zero. We use zero water in our production, whereas for every T-shirt on a volume production cycle is, you know, 2.5 liters. So it's a hell of a lot of water just to produce one T-shirt. So we're removing that. And obviously water is becoming a valuable commodity, you know, as we kind of go forward. So we want to, you know, conserve it and not use it, you know, where we don't need to use it. And I think that's a big plus for print on demand, especially on the apparel side. You can move on. You know, we're talking about marketing, you can move it on as well. So I think what I'm trying to say here is, coming from a retail direct to consumer perspective, you need to know who your customer is. You need to define your audience. You know, you need to know who they are, where they are, what they like, what they don't like, you know, and then you need to, you know, you need to cater and target your audience, you know, to your audience and speak your audience's language. You know, there's no point in speaking to them, you know, about a print if they want a T-shirt and vice versa. So you really need to understand your audience before you even undertake any kind of a marketing strategy, because you'd be just wasting your time. Be visible and be available. You know, you need to be where your customer is. Where are they hanging out? What language are they speaking? What conversations are they having? And you need to be proactive and be involved in those conversations, you know, and giving them what they want. And then hopefully that will convert, you know, and they'll come and they'll buy and they'll be there. You know, they'll be a lifetime valued customer. And unfortunately, that's what you have to do. You have to be consistently engaging. And when you get it right, as I said at the bottom, you know, you 10x it. You just keep doing the same thing, and you should get the same results. So that's, from a marketing perspective, is quite important to understand who your audience is. You can move it on. So these are just file specifications. You know, for textile, we need a PNG, transparent PNG or a transparent TIFF. We can't use JPEGs when printing textile, because we would print the rasterized white background, because the machines cannot determine between what the artwork is. You know, I'll give you an example. So this is a DTG print. If we were to print that, you know, with a white background, we would have no way, or the machine would have no way of deciphering what the actual artwork is against what the background is. So if it was printing on a dark garment, you would have a white box effectively. So that's the necessity for transparency. Trim to pixel, it's not necessary, but it's a nice to have. Color profiles, ICC profiles, again, RGB, minimum file resolution, 300 DPI. You know, we can handle anything up to 1200 DPI. So that's a minimum of 300 DPI. And then for other products like, you know, mugs, phone cases, some other kind of hardline products which are sublimated printed, you can use JPEGs, because they will always start from a white base, very much like if you were printing on paper. But I think you're going to get a copy of these slides, and I'm all happy to answer any questions after, you know, in terms of file specifications, etc. So it's not a problem. And then the last one is execute. And what I mean is, a lot of people talk about doing these things and they've all good intentions, but they never execute. And I think you will never know unless you execute. So I think that's the real takeaway, is if you are going to do something, you know, put a plan together. It doesn't need to be a million products. You know, it can be one product, two products, you know, but I think, you know, you will never know unless you execute. And the technology, especially technology that we're building on Fanbase, you know, makes that automation very, very simple, and that e-commerce integration very, very simple. So there really isn't any excuse not to execute, but, you know, that's a big takeaway, is to execute at the end of the day. So that's it for me.
That's great. Thanks, Mark, for that. That's brilliant. So in this section, I thought it'd be good to pick out some of those questions that I'd asked the attendees to ask the experts. So I've got a couple here, and then I want to go to the queue. There's some questions I can see in the chat. So let's just try and get through these really quick and then try and answer as many as we can in the questions that we have, and James can go through those. So question number one, is print on demand feasible for a very small organization, was from one attendee. So Mark, or would you like to answer that one? Seeing as you kind of cater towards that sort of more that spectrum maybe over King & McGaw.
Yeah. So I would say yes, 100%. There is no minimum order quantity. So, you know, if you sell one t-shirt or one mug or one tote bag a week, or a year, we don't really care. It's a cumulative volume for us in terms of print on demand. So we're not worried whether you sell one or a million. So in terms of an organization size or an individual, you could have only picked up a pen today and started drawing today. And if you want to try sell that product, you know, to a small fan base that you may have, an audience that you may have, for us it doesn't make any difference. We're happy to accommodate that, no problem.
Great. Question number two is, how do you make it cost effective and streamlined? Who would like to answer that?
I don't know if that's cost effective and streamlined for the rights holder or for the fulfillment partner. I suppose from a King & McGaw perspective, we're operating at scale in the print on demand sphere. And for us, everything has to be automated. So we do get requests from organizations or for artists who want to have a more manual model where orders might be emailed to us when they're received, for example. And unfortunately, we have to decline to work in that way, just because, as I mentioned, we're working with 32, I think, museum partners at the moment, in addition to John Lewis and our own D2C website, and all of the orders flow through our factory and studios in an automated way, not in a client by client way. So I think for us, we try and build in some economies of scale, for example, into print on demand. So we have product templates that have the same paper sizes and framing sizes, just so that we can introduce some economies of scale into production, even though the artwork being produced might be individual. But I don't know if that answers that question.
I think so. I think it's about, you know, what they can, organization can actually do about streamlining that process. And it sounds to me that there are print on demand companies trying to make that streamline for them to get them moving and getting that product out there. So I think that's fine. Number three was, what are the timeframes for placing an order and fulfilling? This might be quite different between the pair of you, actually, with a merch versus print.
So fan base, we try and strive for 72-hour dispatch. So if an order is placed on Monday morning, it should, or Sunday evening, it should dispatch no later than Wednesday. So depending on where you are in the world, or, you know, for example, in the UK, if we ship it on a Wednesday, you'll have it on Thursday, Friday maximum. Or your customer will have it. So they're the kind of SLAs that we try and strive for. But obviously with COVID, you know, it could kind of rip that rule book up a little bit. But, you know, we're still kind of hitting, you know, 3 days. Sometimes it's easier. We incentivize our partners to, where possible, to print same day or next day. So we incentivize them so that we can kind of make the experience a lot better for the end consumer by giving them a quicker turnaround. So we don't generally advertise that, but we, you know, 72 hours is kind of our rule of thumb for dispatch.
Cool. Ian, do you want to quickly say about Kim McGall?
Oh, it's interesting. I think it's been governed over the last 20 years by consumer expectations. And unfortunately, because of Amazon, everyone expects everything the next day or even the same day or on a Sunday or dropped by drone, et cetera. But for us, we now try and ship all unframed orders that we receive. I rolled prints the next day and framing, our SLA is 10 working days because everything is hand framed to order, and it's very high quality framing that we're doing. Everything's hand stained in sustainable wood, cast acrylic glaze and things like that. And I think people do understand that for a framed product of that quality, it takes a bit longer, but unframed, we try and ship the next day.
Brilliant. What assets or infrastructure do you need to set up print on demand? I feel like maybe this was kind of spoken about within your sections, but I'm quite keen to find out what questions are on the live. But I think we pretty much got that one covered, unless you guys want to kind of pitch in there.
I would just say, you know, one of the first things you should do before you even think about looking at Shopify or anything like that is make sure you've consolidated all the assets that you may be interested in selling, putting them all in some kind of structure. And then, you know, and then looking at what the requirements are for your particular fulfiller. And then, you know, doing all that preparation in advance will definitely speed things up when you want to start going to, you know, to building out an e-com store, because they're really the overheads is prepping the artwork and prepping the mock-ups and that kind of stuff. It's very time consuming.
Yeah, it's good. That's a good point. And number five was, what is the future for print on demand? Obviously, Mark, you kind of spoke about the sort of size of the merch t-shirt market. It's in the billions, but you know, for organizations wanting to start out on a print on demand, is print on demand a sustainable business model that is worth investing? It'd be really great to hear from both of you just quickly on that before we move on to the live questions.
I would certainly say you could probably rearrange them words a little bit and say the future is print on demand. It's not going anywhere. You know, it's at this point, it's very much a complementary fulfillment model for traditional, especially in the apparel side of things and the merchandise side of things, but more and more that paradigm has shifted. So it's not going anywhere. The technology is getting better. It's getting faster. It's getting cheaper. And the install base in terms of the technology is getting wider. So we're seeing install bases in South America, South Africa, Asia. So we are, you know, we're a fan base. We're building a global infrastructure. So for us, that's where we're looking. We're looking at global. So a single point of entry for global fulfillment. And that's where we see the future of on-demand fulfillment.
Ian, have you got a quick answer for that one?
Well, we always get asked when we're going to move into 3D printing. So I guess 3D printing on demand is something that will no doubt happen in the future. I think what people have been talking about for years, at least in the museum sector, is a sort of print on demand future, which would be app-based and hooked into audio visual guides of some kind, where you'd be able to recognize an artwork as you viewed it in the museum and order it at the same time. And I mean, that's been talked about for well over 10 years, and I'm sure will happen at some point.
Yeah, brilliant. And James, I think we've got about 10 minutes for questions. So if you want to see what they are, we'd be more than happy to answer the next 10 minutes.
Got some great questions from the chat. So thank you, everyone. This one, is one that comes up quite a lot when we speak to organisations, and it's about intellectual property and copyright. So if you're an artist, what should you look out for when it comes to licensing your own work? And then the question follows on about, is there a print-on-demand comparison chart that highlights terms and conditions that favour artists in that way? And then it moves on to a secondary question around copyright. So before sending any artwork to a print on demand, what's the best way to record copyright, and can that be done for free?
Good question. Ian, do you want to kickstart that one?
Yeah, I can do. I suppose in terms of business models, I think the model that's mainly been talked about today is a clear wholesale model where you should be quoted a wholesale price and a shipping price, and then you're free to set your own RRPs, and then it's very clear what money you're going to be making, so you can factor that into your front end hosting and design costs and things like that. I've seen models in the past where people were offering things like profit shares or commission-based models where it gets a bit more nefarious. And then I think contractually, you know, you want to make sure that if you've received a product sample, that it's definitely from a factory and a supplier who's going to be making the finished products for you. You want to make sure contractually you've specified which channels you're happy for your products and your artwork to be available in, or what products it can be on and what channels it can be in. Again, contractually make sure there's a clear sell-off period. So if you choose to end a particular relationship, that it's very clear for how long work could carry on being sold, and making sure that the credit lines are on every product as well. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, I think that covers some points of it. Yeah, definitely. So if I had a piece of art that I'm putting out there, you're saying make sure that it's nailed down in the contract where and when it can be shared, how long that lasts, and then the type of channels that it can be used on. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. For copyright, if you're an artist, it's your copyright until 75 years after your death or 70 years after your death. And there are organizations such as DAX, which is the Design and Artist Copyright Society, who can work to collect royalties on your behalf. But there's obviously a cost involved to that process. But sadly, you know, artists' ideas do get ripped off out there. But hopefully, if you can prove that it's your artwork and you published it on a certain date before somebody else did, then, you know, you should have full recourse to claim those royalties.
Brilliant. Thanks very much. The next question is around platforms. There are so many different platforms out there when it comes to e-commerce. Are there any print-on-demand e-commerce platforms that work better with print on demand, or does it just work with any platform? Can it be a bespoke platform?
I think, from our perspective, looking at the market share in terms of e-commerce platforms, Shopify is kind of winning hands down at this point in time. But what we are seeing is a massive shift towards what's called social commerce. So we are seeing that you may have seen Facebook shops and Instagram checkout. So effectively the model seems to be that people will no longer have unnecessary websites. So they won't have a website with, you know, 10 pages about me and, you know, and here's, you know, some images from a festival or whatever. It'll basically, the commerce will be driven from their social feeds. So you'll be able to buy directly from Instagram or buy directly from Facebook without being redirected to a Shopify store or another e-commerce platform. So that's where social commerce seems to be. That's the direction we seem to be traveling in. And I think from a platform like Fanbase, it's in our interest, obviously, to integrate with those sales channels. So that's where we see the direction of travel. But I think all in all, Shopify is probably the easiest and the quickest to get up and running.
Yeah, so I obviously quite a lot using print on demand with Shopify, but obviously they can use other ones as well.
Yeah.
I think it's really important to kind of, when you are looking at print on demand suppliers, like who do they integrate with, is be one thing that you should always check, and also make sure that they are either building APIs that will be integrated with you. Say you're on Squarespace, you built your website on that, it's all fresh, it's all new this year, you want to be able to add Squarespace shops, but then you realize, oh, who can you integrate with print on demand? It's just something to consider. It might change your shop platform based upon which print on demand company you can use. So yeah, it's best to check which ones are going that direction, because they may be building an API with, say, Shopify, WooCommerce, etc.
And when it comes to integration with the different platforms, I imagine it's very different depending on the platform and the print on demand provider. The time scale can be very different.
And it could, in some cases, James, it can just come down to the niche that you're targeting. You know, do they use Shopify, or are they more inclined to use a social commerce kind of model, which I've explained, where they see all of their traction on their social feeds rather than on a website, you know? So it really depends on your business and what niche you're kind of operating in, you know?
The next set of questions we've got are around when you're choosing a print and on demand partner. The first question is around the actual credit check. So that was mentioned as we went through the slides about how would you go about ensuring that they could deliver what they're offering. Is there a process you go through, or is there a tried and tested method?
I think just a due diligence period, in the same way that you would for any area of your business. You know, if you're looking at working with someone, you're perfectly within your rights to request trade references or to get in touch with people they claim to be working with, or to check their details at Companies House, etc. It's all quite straightforward, I would say.
And also, I forgot to mention during my slides that there is a downloadable that will be accompanying this webinar, which is how to choose the right print on demand partner, that I've actually spoke to quite a few different print on demand companies about kind of getting that checklist together. So that'll be something that you can download and which you can use as point reference as well.
Perfect. A ready made resource. Well done, Emma. That might answer some of these other questions then. One of them is around choosing a print on demand partner. Should it be, is there any legal issues that mean you should choose one that's based in the UK, or can it be international? Mark's going to say, yeah, he chooses us.
No, we're all global. We're global citizens now with global trade. No, I don't see any legal issues, you know.
I think it's just preference, isn't it, really? Yeah. If you want to, I mean, the one for that artist store, they chose a London-based one because they potentially want to do some customized prints that are hand-finished. So that's why that was chosen. So I think it, rather than the Latvian print on demand, you know, they both can deliver the same. The costs were still the same. The pricing was still the same. So I think it's just down to personal preference and where it's not necessarily a legality issue.
Brilliant. Another one, I think you showed examples of this, Emma, about actual artist proof. So if you want to do an art print or a publication, do print on demand companies provide you with a proof that you can check to make sure you're happy with it before committing to working with them?
Yeah, they should be able to give you, I mean, in terms of high res, they don't know necessarily what the image or necessarily what the file looks like, which is why I'd always say to, you know, provide your highest red, like, and also like 300 DPI, don't go underneath that. If you get like a book or something or some prints made, you know, just get a sample made, make sure you're happy with the res of that image, because a print on demand company might not have been able to see that, you know, in real life. So they don't know what the point reference is. Yeah. So yeah, always get a sample to see if you're happy, because at the end of the day, you don't want the end customer to be unhappy. Because that would completely mess up the whole brand, you know, and the relationship. So making sure that you're getting high res and you're getting samples and you're happy with the end result, I think is really key.
Brilliant. Thing on
it doesn't cost that much money either. No. It's low risk.
Yeah, on our platform.
They do free ones occasionally, but you're...
We give discounts for samples. So we'll give people 5 samples a month, for example, quite a generous discount off the cost of goods price, so they can sample. But I definitely agree, especially if you're new to a print method like direct to garment or direct to textile, and you want to see how your artwork is going to be produced on that medium. You may have never seen your artwork on textile before, and you may spine, because it's a matte finish, you may feel a little bit underwhelmed when you see it, but it's just because it's that particular type of medium that you're printing on. So you just need to be conscious of that kind of stuff.
Fantastic. There's a couple more questions around cost and brand merchandise, but I think they were covered in the session, and the following resources you send, Emma, I think I didn't cover that. So the last question I've got in here is about creating a special limited edition feel for anything you create through print on demand. What are the tips for doing something like that? Is it possible? Can you do it with print on demand? Have a limited edition and make that really special print exclusive thing?
I would say yes, but I can let Mark and Ian give examples of what special looks like for print on demand.
From our side, I would say that the prints that we produce as open editions for print on demand are produced to the same quality that we would when we're making limited editions for museums, in the sense that the paper stocks that we use are the same, the printing techniques are the same, but for us, print on demand is a templated approach. So there are certain special finishes we use for museums, limited editions. So things like hand tearing, die cut embossing stamps, obviously hand numbering, signatures, certificates of authenticity, that for us at least are not possible to do on an on demand basis. But if you're in control of the front end, there's no reason why you couldn't have a counter saying that something's only available for 200, and then after your 200th order you turn it off at the front end. That's certainly possible. I mean, the Penguin project we worked on for their 85th anniversary, they said that things would just be available for 85 days, for example, so that got around having to turn it off at exactly the 85th days. But there is a differential, but if you're working with a quality partner, there's no reason why you couldn't, again, come up with inventive ways to still, you could provide a certificate yourself after someone has purchased, for example.
Yeah, we're working on stuff such as, I'll just show you, I don't know if you can see it, but this is a guitar plectrum. And we've embedded an NFC chip into this guitar plectrum. So it means we can trigger content on any smartphone. So it means we can do stuff like that. That can also be just directed to a landing page that says, this is an authentic piece of merchandise or whatever. So you can do certification that way. Plus we're doing a lot around image recognition software as well, where you can scan an image on a t-shirt and again, trigger content or trigger an activation or an experience. And that can be as simple as an anti-piracy landing page or an authentication landing page that this is one of 200 units and it's number 52, and and here's your digital certificate for that.
Amazing, yeah.
That piece of merchandise, so we're always looking at different ways of doing that, from a piracy, anti-piracy authentication, as well as the more kind of fun stuff in terms of activations and content delivery and engagement as well.
Fantastic. I think that's a brilliant idea, yeah. That using digital technology in that way.
Yeah.
So that's all we've got time for today, I'm afraid. So thank you, Emma. Thank you, Mark. And thank you, Ian. Really interesting stuff there. As we said before, this is going to be available as a recording on our website. You'll also be able to download Emma's fantastic list and extra resources, and then the stuff that Mark and Ian can provide as well. So please look on at the website. We'll send an email to you with all that information on, so you can just check that out. If you do want support from us, so the Digital Culture Network team, we can offer one-to-one support for arts and culture organisations for free. So please do get in touch to see if you're eligible, and then we can take you on this journey and guide you through it. We've got a couple more webinars coming up that you might be interested in. There's loads on our website, so please check them out there. But the next one is tomorrow, which is the Connected to Culture webinar, which is all about diversifying your generating your revenue streams and diversifying your income. And then next week, we've got an introduction to email marketing with Peggy. So please do join us on those. Anything from you, Emma?
No, that's brilliant. I just want to say thanks for people who have attended today. I hope it's been useful. Thank you to my two special guests, Mark and Ian, for agreeing to be on the webinar today. I think it's been really insightful. And yeah, if you need any further help with print on demand, you've got further questions, please feel free to get in touch with me once I've sent the resources out. Thank you.